everybody. I think, yes, still the morning time. Morning. We've been chatting, we've been chatting a lot this morning. So here I am again. Yes, that's not true. Here we are again at the Brandman home and today talking to Carol. So good morning, Carol, and thank you for letting me come today.
Sue, it's lovely to have you here. It's really good.
I'm enjoying our time here, my time, and learning so much about the band. So what's your connection with the band?
Well, I got to do that trip that John raved on about and saw the bands in New York and was equally inspired. However, at that time when we came back, I was still working full-time and studying. So although I was keen to get going, I had to sort of hold back a bit. So I wasn't in that first beginner group. When I had a bit of time and I came into it, I started on flute, which was my old high school instrument.
Right.
And my hands didn't like that too much. So then I thought I'll go back to trumpet, which I'd played as a very young child. And then I thought, I've never really played a bass instrument. And I started with the baritone, and that's when things really took up. I felt really that I enjoyed the sound.
I'm here.
And I'm here, and I'm going to learn, and I'm going to learn bass clef, which... it's a bit like a cryptic crossword. I went from treble and trumpet fingering to, you know, I felt like my whole head was turned upside down. And I think it took me 12 months to stop switching all the fingering around.
Right.
So, and I loved it. I really loved it. So, yeah, that's what I'm still playing, or I've gone on to the euphonium and sort of making progress from group one through now to group three over the past 4 or 5 years, yeah.
And you make some wonderful contributions to the band, though. It's not just being a partner of the originator.
Yeah, well, what I love is teaching, and I was trained as a teacher. And so what I was hoping is that people would feel that if there was something they didn't want to ask in front of a group, or they needed extra help with, or if Joe said to me, look, someone in group one could benefit, use me, you know,
right.
And I'd be more than happy. And I've got to meet some really wonderful people through that. And sometimes I can just, the pleasure is seeing the penny drop, you know, when I'm asked a question, I go, well, you know, you're only confused about blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
And when you can explain it a slightly different way and there's a bit more time, then hopefully that's been helpful as well.
Well, you're often the first person that we meet when we start going down there on a Thursday morning.
Yeah, so I seem to have got that role, which I think it's because I just talk too much. But I like talking and welcoming people and making them feel... Look, I know how scary it is starting something new, and I think everybody expects that we expect they'll know something.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
trying to reassure and say... You don't have to know anything, and you don't have to do it at any pace. I think that's important, so that if you want to do group one and do it again and do it again, that's fine, because you're still playing and you're still making music.
It's a journey,
and you're
isn't
still
it?
In a group. It is,
yes.
And there's no rush. I mean, you know, you haven't made, people haven't played for 60 years. Well, you know, if they don't play perfectly for another two, that's not, you know, a problem. So I think it's important that some people have a little bit more confidence, but often when I meet the new people, they're more worried about, you know, maybe holding other people up looking like they don't know what they're doing.
Making a
mistake. None of us like making.
Well, as a newbie who hasn't played any wind instrument or brass instrument, that orientation for me was fantastic because, you know, given a range of instruments, try the clarinet, try the saxophone, try the trumpet, you know, it sort of... It opened a door that you think, well, I'm no good at that, but hey, this one's not too bad, I'll give this a go.
Yeah, Jen and I used to say with our year threes that we used to try out in schools, you know, there's a whole shoe shop full of shoes.
Absolutely.
And it's a matter of finding one that that fits.
Mm-hmm.
It fits a little
mm-hmm.
bit better. And sometimes you have to try one or two before that happens, but sometimes you just get that feeling, yeah, I think I could play that, and I'm glad that helped.
Oh, absolutely. Well, I mean, there's no other way of doing it. I mean, you can't start hiring instruments to find out what fits.
It's a tricky one, and that's another thing that can hold people from getting underway.
Absolutely.
But,
you're given a range to try.
But usually we've got a few that we can loan for at least a few weeks, or, you know, get you settled into what you feel comfortable with.
Well, so I think after I chose the clarinet, I think I was off to the music store to hire one and buy the books, you know. I was at home half an hour later just having it a go.
And look, and it sort of also works as it grows. There's people who are switching instruments, and there's a few in store too that sometimes if people can't get an instrument going or rent, that we can lend or loan, you know what I'm saying? Because as it grows, there's a few more instruments in the system. So that's good too.
So you mentioned that you played a flute. How many instruments do you play, and did you play as a child?
All right, so my family background, we grew up very much involved with the Salvation Army. My dad was a conductor of one of the brass bands in the Salvation Army. So my first instrument was a tenor horn when I was about 6 or 7, and I probably played that, I don't know, for primary school for a little bit.
That's wonderful.
And then when I got to high school, I thought, what a stupid instrument. I just wanted to play the flute. So I was able to get hold of a flute, and I had a few lessons, and on and off, we didn't have a lot of music at the high school. I played flute with different ensembles, and then I realised that I didn't really have a great flute ensemble sound, and I'd always kept piano going, which is what I'd started on, and that's in fact what I started concentrating on to do all my classical grades and everything. And I think I mentioned to you earlier, I kept it up as one of my core subjects through uni. And so I was always doing, you know, performances on piano and whatever, but deep down I knew that my love was always going to be teaching, and I was never going to be a piano performer. The nerves would have always got to me too much, but, you know, I enjoyed playing it. So I guess I didn't have a music studio in my home, but I had my sisters sang, my dad was always on the piano, my mama had a beautiful voice, and there would always be concerts, you know, so I was always in the choir, and there would always be musicians rehearsing for a concert at our house.
Surrounded
so
by music.
I had that sort of immersion.
So
I never thought of it as a kid, but looking back I realised that it does.
It was inevitable.
Yeah, it does sort of seep into your system.
Yes, indeed, yeah. Osmosis, yes.
Yes.
So you played flute? Piano?
Yeah, well, piano is my main instrument, and early on a bit of brass, and then the flute. And nowadays, you know, again, when you're teaching, we were teaching in the instrumental programs, we had to be able to teach all instruments.
Oh, so, of course, yes.
You know, I used to take a different instrument home and practice so that I could play all of book one, say, on most instruments. You get a bit rusty when you don't, you know, do it all the time, but yeah, basically to be able to teach it. But I guess what doing piano and studying music at uni does for you is it gives you a lot of
gives you the background,
knowledge,
the basics.
That you know, playing an instrument is only a very small part of understanding how to put that into the
get all the theory.
And that's why ultimately I've got round to involving kids in ensemble or band playing, or in our case adults, because you're applying so much of watching a conductor, listening to others, playing in time, whereas when you're isolated and playing music, you don't learn all that.
No, it's what we get from the band, isn't it?
Yep.
Working together,
yep.
Listening to the others, and working on dynamics.
That's right. All of those things that you can, if you're on your own, you can kind of cheat on or not even think about, whereas the band makes you more aware, I think, or playing in an ensemble makes you more aware, and that's what I, now you can ask me probably what do I enjoy, that's one of the main things I enjoy, having to not go off on my own, working with everybody else.
It's another form of a discipline too, isn't it?
Yeah, that's very true. And I was just in that bit on background of learning, after I met John, he touched on, I was learning piano at his parents' studio, so that's how we first met, if anybody wants to know. Yeah, it was before he flitted off overseas for over 12 months. But anyway, when I was then finished my degree, thinking would go into somewhere into economics and government or teaching economics, I had the opportunity to do my DPED in music, and it kind of made sense to me, well, John likes music, I like music, maybe I should try music. And I think that was a turning point, because I've had so much more fun teaching music and doing shows and musicals and playing in ensembles and choirs and things than I think I would have ever had teaching economics. So I sort of feel like I dodged a bullet there, although I'm still very interested in politics and everything as yes. sort of a hobby of mine. But
I think kids get far more excited going to a music class than they would to an economics lesson.
Yeah, well, I know I used to. I used to love that. And, the fun of seeing kids have a relief from all the pressure of sometimes the other subjects.
Absolutely.
And kids that are a bit emotional or have other issues. Mm-hmm. Music is such a wonderful
and good for those kids that aren't, you know, academic trained.
Academics. But, yeah I think if you love teaching music and you love being involved with that, it was a real bonus for me. And that meant when John did come back from overseas, we were also playing together in a club band.
So
we played all over New South Wales at different clubs, backing artists as they used to do in those days. And that was a hoot at that stage. And then we also played a lot of wedding reception places. So we didn't get up to too much mischief because we were pretty much working
absolutely
hard, you know. So
by the time you get there and the sound check and then perform. And
but at that age and being able to, you know, go head out to Katoomba or up to Woi Woi or, you know, down the coast, when I look back, you know, we were earning half decent money and we weren't spending it, you know. Yes.
You were too busy. Yeah. That lovely thing on the net that, you know, you have a $5,000 instrument, you put in into a $500 car for a $50 gig.
Yeah, I don't think you really ever come out in front with all of that. But
just going back to the school too, because music's such a critical part of this generation's life, isn't it? I mean, they're all writing music, they know the words of all the songs, so music is really such a part of their lifestyle.
Probably in some respects, like a lot of things with the internet, it's more accessible. Mm. And they've got, even if you can't read music, you can still compose because you can use all these programs. Mm. But in all honesty, music was a big part of everybody's life, particularly when you're growing up. But then, as I've heard listening to your interviews, there's very few people that say, well, no, music doesn't, you know. I mean, you remember things by the music you hear and you feel better. Like, I know I come out of Thursday morning with, you know, a buzz.
A buzz, yep.
And it's not because, you know, I played particularly well. It's just because I was surrounded by this great sound. And, I think people do get that with the recording as well. They'll put headphones on and it'll just take them out of that.
Well, it's another sense. It's like no taste, you know, the smell. I mean,
true.
Conjures up wonderful memories and emotions and so with it, and touch. Yeah. So same thing with oral.
I wonder, I think there are some people that don't get people who are into music. There's a few, and, you know, I suppose it's no different to musicians who don't get sport, you know. There's a bit of that. But, I don't know that there's that many people that don't have something in their life that relates all that music helped them get through or, you know, at various times.
Well, I mean, sounds all around you in various forms, isn't it?
Yeah.
Melodic or not.
That's right. And sometimes I find it hard to find silence, which is why I do like sometimes going where there's no music. There's always, you know, a bit of
background. Just what's happening around you.
Yeah.
So music means a lot to you, obviously. It's your life, I would think.
It has turned out that way, probably more than I had originally anticipated, but I don't think I'd have wanted it any way different. I think John and I have both been, really just passionate about it. And at least you can see, once you start us talking.
Yeah, well, you had no option, really. Yeah. Surrounded from childhood.
There's so many avenues that music has infiltrated and I can just see how much it gives back. And I'm still getting, you know, to think I'm getting pleasure from just learning and being involved in that ensemble now is great. But also, I wrote down two words when I was thinking of you coming today, and I wrote down that live and passionate are two important things. I think live music can't be replaced by recorded music.
No.
Recorded music is great, but being there and feeling that presence there and music doesn't have to be perfect, it just needs to have that passion. And I think that's what I'm looking for more in order to make that effort to go and hear
more music, right. Especially these days with COVID, with so many clubs closing down.
It is a different environment, and people have got so many good things in home now with their sound systems and whatever. They sometimes, I think, don't feel they need to get out. And I know I'm a bit the same sometimes.
No, I'm a bit lazy. No.
Yeah, you think, oh, well, you know, blah, blah, blah. But when you do go, you don't regret it.
So what's your favourite musical experience with the band?
Now, with the band, we were talking about the fact that it's the involvement of people and the interrelationship that you develop with them. That's always fun. And seeing that development of, you know, I can't play or I can play.
Another
or
growth, right.
And then that growth through and the buzz, like I often lean across to Kathy and I'll say, we did it, you know. And it's like, yeah, those moments are really special because sometimes we just sit there and go, oh, my gosh, we just stuffed that, you know.
And you don't get that often as an adult. I mean, you're doing with kids all the time. Oh, yeah, well done. Yeah, oh, done. You did that. Aren't you clever? But you don't get that often as an adult.
And yet, you know, I see these great transitions, you know, and people like, oh, Noreen, I watched her, you know, her saxophone wasn't working and she's so frustrated, and yet then she got it working and all the notes came back. And to me, like, that made my day. And I'm thinking, you know, she could have easily just given up and, you know, she's in there and doing it. So that's sort of the people we have in the band that motivate me to go, well, look at them. They overcame that.
Yes.
So can I, you know, and it's a good life lesson, you know. So those people have been so inspiring to me playing, and the performances are always a buzz because having been on the other side, like conducting and whatever, and it made me realise when I did a couple of my first performances, I was so nervous. You know, and it really made me relive what it's like.
Yes.
And you just take for granted, well, what, come on, get on with it. No. You put yourself under a lot of pressure and the adrenaline goes, and you've got to learn to respond to that.
Mm.
So, yeah, all the performances are great for that reason, and the feeling of, wow, we did it.
You know? Bringing pleasure to others.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's another side of it too. But, yeah, it is a challenge to get there and actually do the job well.
Yes, fit it in.
Yeah.
So what about outside the band? What are your favourite musical experiences there?
I jotted a few things down because, you know, I tend to forget things. But I'm lucky to have the opportunity to see quite a few musicals. I don't love every musical, but I get really sucked into some. And the latest one, if you ask me, and don't ask me now because it's got to be finished soon, is Hamilton.
Oh,
so
well.
I am totally immersed in Hamilton.
Okay.
So I was so excited when we got to go and see it, and in real life. And it's not just because I thought I would never like anything to do with rap, but it's the cleverness of it and the history of it and just the whole production of it. So I tend to be a little bit like, if something really grabs me,
right,
and particularly in musical theatre or theatre generally, I get my fists in it and bore everybody to tears. So at the moment it's Hamilton. But going back, this has been nice because it made me think a little bit about what do I really love? There's so many things you could say, as many of them have brought up, but we've had a lot of opportunity to travel with our kids.
Right.
We mentioned earlier that we were lucky to have them all be involved in the stage band at Kirrawee High, and they were always a touring band. So we were able to go twice with different kids to Cuba.
Oh, wow.
We were the first school band to John Winners, the sound person and the repair person. And they were amazing trips in themselves. But one thing still gives me goosebumps. We were there in the week before Christmas, and we went to a performance by the Havana National Baroque Orchestra.
Oh.
So it was a performance of Bach in the Havana Cathedral, Cristobal.
Oh, wow.
Like 1500s built, you know, all the things. And we all sat there and all the school kids came with us. And at the end of the performance, which was magical and it wasn't too long, the kids took it on well. I loved it. we stood up and we all sang Silent Night.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my gosh. And it was because of the acoustics and their traditional orchestra and the place.
The accompaniment would be brilliant.
It was the most... It was simple, it was slow, and to this day I feel like I can hear every word of that. And that was just, you know, how beautiful a melody can be and a circumstance. So I class that as...
And universal.
Yes, in and all languages, all sang, and they all sang it in Spanish and English and whatever else. So that,
wonderful.
That still is still magical to me, and probably, look, I could mention a few others, but we... follow Arturo Sandoval, who was a Cuban trumpet player and American, and we're in San Francisco with our kids, and he was doing a small concert associated with a Japanese restaurant, of all things. It was a very small room, and we got tickets.
Wow.
And so we all went, and he was like from here to there, and he plays piano brilliantly too. And in terms of the big band jazz piano trumpet player, it was just an hour, and it was gobsmackingly beautiful. Just
so, filled you up.
Yeah, and the kids, there was one of our mates, boys' mates there, who is a trumpet player, and like he was like, I can still see his face. It was just one of those out of the blue things that happened. It was very special.
Spontaneous, wonderful.
Yep. So they were my two picks in the musical.
Favourite musical performer or... style of genre of music?
Oh, look, I'm a funny one. I probably like, I'm very eclectic. One of the best concerts I love was Ricky Martin.
Oh, right, yes.
And everybody
goes,
oh my God, you didn't go to that concert, but I danced the whole way through and he was gorgeous. I thought he did a great concert. There's, look, so many classical performers. I probably can't even start to name. I love Diana Krall, love her ballads. I listened to her, one that she's done of the 70s hits.
Oh, right, yes.
It's just a beautiful general album, which I really enjoy. I listen to that often. I love Cat Empire. Hardly miss a concert of theirs. They're an Australian band. They do influenced by world music.
Right, yeah,
and
yeah.
They do great live concerts.
Wow.
And so they're one I play a lot. So they're just a few, very diverse. But I'll also play, not usually when John's around, but I do like classical music as well.
Right. Well, I mean, you've got a lovely big open space here, and it must be great acoustics with the tiles. And
it's lovely. We wouldn't have music going a lot, I've got to say.
Yes. Yeah. And greatest challenges?
Well, we mentioned, being a music teacher, you'd think that I could tick a lot of boxes, but when I'm playing the baritone, I have a lot of trouble pitching. Particularly now I'm playing higher notes, so I'm trying to get better at hearing the note I need to play.
Right.
And I need to improve that a lot. So, Jo, come and sit next to us again, please. She helps us lots. That other part of it is I realised as a piano player, I know how to count and read the rhythms, but because you play two hands, I don't think linear in rhythm like you do on an instrument.
Right.
And each instrument, I think, in the band has particular patterns that it plays.
Right,
like we do a
yeah.
lot of that and pop, 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 and across two and three bars. And I get left behind. And I'm trying to get better at making sure I actually know where those rhythms
right,
land, you
right.
know. And that's this year I've really been trying to get better at doing
I think
and practicing more.
Yeah, well, you're not the only one with either of those. It's the counting I don't do. I should count more. I try to... I think I've got the melody in my head and I just play what's in my head, but that's often not the right way.
And I reckon sometimes I'm counting and I think Jenny gets it wrong, you know.
Shh.
Don't say that.
Yeah. And the benefits from the group or benefits from music?
I think everybody has known all the things about the brain, so I'm getting big picture here, but the involvement in using all parts of your brain is still, to me, one of the greatest benefits that I see across the board or in all age groups. And I feel very good when I know that the Greeks thought it essential part with poetry and drama because they recognised that everything else was improved by people who use the spatial left, right hand side of the brain. So it's also something, you know, from the heartbeat the mother first has in the womb. It's the rhythm and of music is something so much part of our inner creativity and soul that although we have to sometimes earn a living not involved in that, it doesn't stop us from benefiting from all those extra side effects. Yep. So that's a very broad answer to your question. I think now that I'm not working in my normal job or what I had been doing, I think this is particularly one of those interests that I'm really glad I've joined, and I do see benefits every
do it for you.
Yeah, and it's a bit of a selfish thing, eh?
That's terrible.
Oh, shocking. No, I still want to do some artwork yet. Maybe, I'm not sure which, but at the moment I've
I'll put that on the list.
Yeah, and then you know what are we talking? Family history, you know, like
I'm, yes. Oh, the list gets longer and longer.
Absolutely.
So I was going to ask, it follows on with what other interests do you have?
Well, because I've been talking far too long, probably. The interest John had mentioned, when I turned 40, I went back to bike riding. It's very social, but I love to get, I have a smile on my face when I'm riding my bike. And so that's definitely, that alternating with kayaking means now you can't play a competitive sport, or I can't anymore. It's been a great way to keep intact physically, and it's forced us to keep fitted to be able to do it. And then, as John said, the travel, we've managed to link with those activities. So that, and as everybody knows, we always disappear for a few weeks in winter to go skiing.
Well, nothing wrong with
and,
that.
So as long as we can, I have to tell everybody that was really good. He got a discount ski ticket this year because he's reached that age, you know, where you're not really, hardly anybody else has left skiing.
Well, I mean, you know, he probably wouldn't be on the slopes till 11 and come off at 2, well, one of those.
I can't imagine it. No,
he gets his
FOMO, you know, fear of missing out.
If
he's, if he's inside and it looks like he should be skiing, he can't
get,
he'll be back out again. Whereas I'm a little bit more like those people I used to laugh at, you know, oh, maybe time for a coffee. So we're very fortunate. And, of course, we haven't mentioned that we have our first grandchildren in the last 4 months. So we're a bit besotted by that. Didn't know whether we would be. But, yeah, we spend a lot of time now. You know, they want to have us in their lives. So back doing...
I hope you buy them some of those little tiny maracas and a tiny little tambourine.
Yeah, they're around. The 2-year-old's on the drum kit when he came.
There we go.
So it started.
Another generation.
Yeah.
Oh, look, that's wonderful. Thanks, Carol. I've really enjoyed our chat this morning.
Yeah, it's brought up lots of memories, and what I wasn't thinking of it, you know, being so useful to sort of put your thoughts together. So thank you for asking.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Been a pleasure.
And thank you to all of my band buddies because, it's made for a lot of fun.
Well, thank you for today and for also your involvement with the Shire New Horizons Band.
Pleasure.
Well, that's it for us this morning. So see you next time. Ciao, everyone. Bye.
Folks like to get away, take a holiday from the neighborhood, hop a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood. But I'm taking a Greyhound on the Hudson River line. I'm in a New York state of mind. Seen all the movie stars in their fancy cars. cars and their limousines. Been high in the Rockies, under the evergreens. I know what I'm needing. I'm in a New York state of mind.